Hello, my dear students. Good morning to all of you. Today, I welcome you all to this class. Today's topic is cosmic rays. Now, what do you mean by cosmic rays? Cosmic rays are highly penetrating radiations which are continually entering the Earth's atmosphere in all directions from outer space and with high velocity, approximately equal to velocity of light 3×10⁸ meter per second, and have great amount of energy of the order of 15 GeV. Now, these are cosmic rays, but what are these? What are these cosmic rays? What are the effects of these cosmic rays? What happens when they enter into our Earth's atmosphere, and what do they come from? So, today we will discuss all these queries. Now, first let us see how these cosmic rays are discovered. Alistair Gatel in 1899 and C.T.R. Wilson in 1900 found that the surge of a well-insulated electroscope leaked away slowly even in the absence of any ionizing agent. At first, it was thought that the discharge of this electroscope was due to the presence of the radioactive radiation present in the Earth's surface. Now, what is an electroscope? Let us see. It is just a rod, say brass rod, brass, and top of which there is a knob, and at the other end of the rod there are two leaves. These are gold leaves, and this is kept in a vacuum glass chamber and well insulated. So these are insulation. So if this is kept in a vacuum well insulated glass chamber, then if you bring some charged body near to this knob, then charge will flow through this brass rod and come to the gold leaves. And if then the two gold leaves are charged with the same charge. So if they are charged with the same charge, then what will happen? They will deflect. So the two gold leaves will deflect like this. So it establishes that the object you put is a charged object, and if this object is not a charged object, then the leaves cannot deflect. So this is the electroscope, and after this experiment from 1911 to 1913, Victor has measured radiation levels at various altitudes in his series of balloon experiments in the Earth's atmosphere, and he found that radiation levels increased with altitude, and this radiation was called cosmic radiations, and later it was known as cosmic rays, and the name cosmic ray was given by Millikan, and has awarded Nobel Prize in 1936 for this achievement. Now, we know cosmic rays, but what are these rays? Cosmic rays are coming from outer space, and cosmic rays are high speed protons and electrons, primary particles which strike Earth's atmosphere and after that nuclear collisions produce a shower of secondary particles called the muons, and it is mainly these muons that are observed on Earth's surface. Now see, these are cosmic rays, coming from the outer space and it enters the Earth's atmosphere. Here this blue color indicates, this blue color indicates the, our Earth's atmosphere, and when these cosmic ray particles enter into our Earth's atmosphere, then collision takes place with the gas molecules present in our atmosphere and secondary particles are produced, and all these are called cosmic rays. So we know what are cosmic rays. The rays, the protons, highly energetic protons and other heavy particles that come from outer space. But from where? Outer space, we know outer space, but from where? So there may be three possible origins of cosmic rays. The first one is maybe from the explosion theory. It may be originate from the sun. Our sun may be the origin of the cosmic ray. And the third one is they originate from the cosmic ray stars. Now see, in the explosion theory, the it was thought that in the Big Bang, once upon a time, the whole mass of the universe was concentrated in a single nucleus. About 15 billion years ago, universe exploded, forming galaxies which are still running from each other, running away from each other. In this, great amount of radiation was formed, and these cosmic rays are simply the debris, the dust of the explosion. So what happens in the Big Bang? In this Big Bang, it creates a lot of high energy gamma rays, and when they collide, when gamma rays collide, they produce high energetic particles, positron and electron. So some of these particles may have become what we now call the cosmic rays. But this explosion theory does not explain the existence of heavy atomic nuclei in the cosmic ray. So if such a big explosion occurs, then it is not possible that there exists some heavy nuclei, because it will split into its constituent particles, that is protons, electrons. So we cannot accept the explosion theory, because it cannot explain the existence of heavy nucleus in the cosmic ray. Next, the cosmic rays may be originate from the sun, our sun. At the time of solar activity, violent eruptions occur and ionized gases shoot out from the sun. Some of protons in the sun acquire high energy and thrown into the interplanetary space, and these protons we may call this the cosmic rays. And it is observed that at the time of solar activity, means when solar flares occur, then the intensity of cosmic ray also increases. With solar activity, when sun is more active, then the intensity of cosmic rays also increases. But if sun is the origin of the cosmic ray, then we must observe a day and night variation of cosmic ray. But from experiments, it is observed that the intensity remains almost uniform during the day and night. So sun is the origin of cosmic ray, we cannot accept this. Next, the most, okay, sorry, next we consider origin of cosmic ray as the cosmic ray stars, and this is the most likely possibility. So what happens in cosmic ray stars? A massive star explodes and ejects protons, electrons, and high energetic particles. These particles may become the origin of cosmic rays. Now, I want to see you some examples of cosmic ray stars. This is Crab Nebula shows the destroyed part of a supernova. This is the destroyed part of a supernova. So, from this, high energetic particles may emit. And Crab Nebula, the shape is just like a crab. Crab Nebula shows this type of jets, and along these jets, high energy particles may eject. You know what is a pulsar. So, pulsar is a rapidly rotating star, and if jets move very quickly the earth, then we see a pulse. Particles can be ejected out from these jets. So, these particles may be observed at Earth as cosmic rays. This figure shows that some galaxies have large radio jets. These jets are emitting all wavelengths. So, they also can eject the high energy particles. And this galaxy shows strong jets, and it was thought to have a supermassive black hole in the nucleus of this type of galaxies, and high energy particles emitted along these jets. Gamma ray bursts may also be the origin of the cosmic rays. What is gamma ray bursts? Actually, two neutron stars collide and emit high energy particles. This figure shows two neutron stars collide, and as a result, gamma ray burst occurs, and high energetic particles are emitting from this. So, we already discussed all three possibilities of origin of cosmic rays. Now, current view is that sun emits low energy cosmic rays and high energy cosmic rays are emitted by the cosmic ray stars within our galaxy. And we already know that cosmic ray particles have very high amount of energy. So, regarding tremendous energies of cosmic rays, most scientists believe that protons acquire acceleration in interstellar magnetic field. So, the energy of the particles may accelerate and they acquire very high amount of energy. This cosmic ray shows four types of effects. These are latitude effect, east-west effect, and altitude effect and longitude effect. Now, I want to discuss the latitude effect. See, if we plot the variation of cosmic ray intensity with latitude, then we observe that if we plot the latitude in the x-axis, latitude, and in the x-axis intensity of cosmic ray, that is I, if we plot and let this is 0 degree, that is equator, and from equator say this is towards north 40 degree, say 90 degree, and equator towards south 40 degree, 90 degree. Now if we plot the observations, observed data, that is intensity of cosmic rays, then we have seen that the intensity shows this type of pattern. Now you see, at the equator, you see a low value of cosmic ray. And as we move from equator towards poles, whether it is north pole or south pole, the intensity increases gradually. And after approximately 42 degree latitude, it acquired the highest value and is constant to 90 degree. So, from this observation, we find that from approximately 42 to 90 degree latitude, the cosmic rays intensity are greater and constant. Now, what is the reason behind this? Why the equatorial intensity is lower than the polar intensity? So, see, this is our Earth. Okay, this is North Pole and this is South Pole. So, this is equator, say east and west. We know that our Earth has magnetic field. So, if we plot the magnetic field lines, it will be like this. It will be like this. So, when cosmic ray particles enter into our Earth atmosphere, then it will interact with the, it will be affected by the Earth's magnetic field. So, when the particles come like this or like this at the equatorial region, at this region, what happens? The direction of they come and the direction of field, magnetic field lines is perpendicular. So, the particle will experience a force F is equal to Q V B sine of theta. Here Q is the charge on the cosmic ray particle, V is the velocity of the cosmic ray particle and B is the intensity of magnetic field, Earth's magnetic field, and theta is the angle between the direction of the particle, direction of movement of the particle and the field line. So, here it is 90 degree. So, here sine theta equal to sine 90. So, this is 1 and this value is maximum for sine theta. So, force is maximum in the equator. So, if the particle experiences a maximum force, then it will deflect more. So, the particles deflect more with greater force. So, they deflect more and at the polar region, at the poles, what happens? At pole, the cosmic ray particles comes like this. So, the direction of motion of the particle is parallel to the Earth magnetic field. So, the angle between the direction of motion of the particle and the Earth's magnetic field is 0. So, here theta is equal to 0. So, the force at polar region here, the force experienced by the cosmic ray particles will be F equal to Q V B sine 0 and this will be minimum. So the particles will experience minimum force, that means they will deflect less, so they can enter into Earth's atmosphere. So we get the result. Result what? The intensity at equator is less and the intensity gradually increases towards poles, and at the poles from 40 degree to 90 degree we get the maximum intensity of cosmic rays. So this is the reason behind the latitude effect. Now see what is east-west effect. East-west effect means number of particles coming from west is greater than east. Number of particles that come from west is greater than east. Why we observe this? This is our Earth. Say this is east and this is west, say north. And cosmic ray particles come so here the field lines, magnetic field lines and the direction of motion of the particles are perpendicular. So they will experience a force perpendicular in a direction perpendicular to both their motion and the magnetic field lines. So according to Fleming's left hand rule, you all know this, three mutually perpendicular directions. So the particle will deflect towards in a direction towards east and perpendicular to the direction of motion of the particle and the field, magnetic field lines. So the particles appears to be come from west. So we observe that the number of particles coming from west is more than the particles come from east. So it also indicates that cosmic ray particles are positively charged particles. And if IW is the intensity of cosmic ray coming from west and IE is the intensity that are coming from east, then east-west asymmetry, west asymmetry is given by IW minus IE by IW plus IE by 2. This is called east-west asymmetry. So this is called the number of particles coming from west is greater than number of particles coming from west, and this is called the east-west effect. Now see what is altitude effect. Altitude effect for the intensity, to observe the intensity of cosmic ray, we measure the ionization produced by the cosmic ray. And if we plot the ionization produced by, if we plot the intensity of cosmic ray with altitude, then it will be like this. At first, I explain another thing. This is north and south, east and west, and this is our latitude. So we choose three latitudinal places, say for 3 degree north, for 38 degree north and for 51 degree north. So at these three places we observe the intensity of cosmic ray at all latitudes, and if we plot this, then it will be like this. In the x-axis this altitude, this in kilometer, and in the y-axis it is the intensity of the cosmic ray. Now if we plot first the for the 3 degree north, say it is 8 kilometer, it is say 24 kilometer. So at first for 3 degree north it is looks like that, for 3 degree north, and for 38 degree north it will be like this, 38 degree north, and for 51 degree north it will be like this. So what we observe, that as altitude increases for all three regions, the intensity of cosmic ray increases, and after that at about 19 to 24 kilometer height it has its maximum value, and after this it decreases, so it is called the altitude effect. With altitude we get a significant variation at all latitudes. So what is the reason behind this, why we observe a maximum intensity at 19 to 24 kilometer? You see, when a cosmic ray enter into our Earth's atmosphere, it will collide with the atomic nuclei which are present in our Earth's atmosphere, then secondary particles are produced, and when secondary particles are produced it is observed that a good amount of secondary particles are produced, approximately 19 to 24 kilometer. So the intensity of cosmic ray is maximum at a height 19 to 24 kilometer. So we observe the altitude effect, and cosmic ray also shows the longitude effect. With longitude we also observe a variation of cosmic ray. So for this again we consider the equatorial plane. So this is north, south, and this is the equator, east, west, and if we observe for different longitudinal points along this equator, say this, these are the points, so having different longitudes, these are longitudes. So if we observe here, the intensity of cosmic rays, then it is observed that at these points cosmic rays are not similar, not same, it varies with the longitude. Why it varies with longitude, why it shows a variation with longitude? It is because our Earth's magnetic field is not symmetrical. The asymmetry of Earth's magnetic field, because of this asymmetry of Earth's magnetic field we get the variation of the cosmic ray intensity, and this is called longitudinal variation. Now cosmic rays are classified in two groups. First one is primary cosmic rays. Primary cosmic rays are just entering our Earth's atmosphere, the highly energetic protons which are coming from the outer space and enter into the Earth's atmosphere, these are called primary cosmic rays. And so 90% of these primaries are of protons, and 9% is helium nuclei, and remaining 1% is the heavy nuclei. So all these are called primary cosmic rays, which carry a heavy amount of energy ranging from 1 MeV to 10 to the power 14 MeV. Now see, what are secondary cosmic rays? Secondary cosmic rays, you know, when cosmic rays are coming from outer space, it enter into our Earth's atmosphere, then nuclear collisions takes place. After that, because of this collision, secondary particles are produced, and these secondary particles mainly muons, mesons, these are called the secondary particles. So here the primary cosmic ray come from the outer space and interact with atomic nuclei. After this, the different secondary particles are produced. Mostly they are heavy nucleus, kaon, pi meson, pi plus, pi minus meson, neutrino, neutron, proton, electron, positron, gamma rays, mu plus, mu minus meson. These are produced and all these are called secondary particles. Below an altitude of 20 kilometer, all cosmic radiation is secondary. So these are cosmic secondary cosmic rays. Now let us see what is cosmic ray showers. Cosmic ray showers, we can explain it by cascade theory of showers. In this theory, two processes are involved, radiative collision and pair production. Now I will explain to you what are these processes. So in cascade theory, two processes are involved. First one is radiative collision, and the second one is pair production. So how it happens? Let us consider a highly energetic electron or positron come from outer space, collide with the molecules present in our Earth's atmosphere. So let it be electron or positron. So this highly energetic electron will interact with the atomic nuclei. So this is the atomic nuclei, and when it collide with the atomic nuclei, it will lose energy. The highly energetic electron will lose energy, and this loss of energy appears as gamma ray photons. So these are gamma ray photons. This is gamma ray photon. And when gamma ray photon appears, it will interact with the electric field of another atomic nuclei. So here is another atomic nuclei, and it will interact with the electric field of the nuclei and totally absorbed. And result of this absorption is the production of two electron, one electron and one positron. This is the pair production. So one pair of electron and positron produced, and in this process approximately 1 MeV amount of energy is used. But these electrons are highly energetic particles, so these electron and positrons have sufficient energy to interact with other nuclei. So this electron will interact with other atomic nuclei. So when it interact, collide with another atomic nuclei, it will lose energy. Same again, the loss of energy appears as photon. And this photon interact with the electric field of another nuclei and totally absorbed and produce a pair of, as a result, electron pair produced, electron and positron pair produced. After this, it will interact with another nuclei, and it loses energy. Again, photon produced. Again, this will interact with the electric field of another nuclei, and as a result, electron-positron pair produced. Here also same electron positron pair will be produced. This positron has sufficient energy, so it will interact with another atomic nuclei. As a result, photon will produce, and this photon interact with the electric field of another nuclei. So, and it is totally absorbed, and result of this is the production of electron and positron. So it will interact with another nuclei. Again, photon will be produced, then it will be absorbed by the nuclei. Again, electron, positron will be produced like this. And this will continue until the individual particles have the critical energy greater than the critical energy. So each individual, until its individual particle energy is less than the critical energy, this will happen, and this is called the cascade theory. In this process, numbers of secondary particles are produced. And what happens in pair production? In this pair production, photon is converted to electron and positron and electron. So here you see photon is chargeless, and these two have charges or equal and opposite charges. So charge is conserved in this. And if we consider energy, let photon has energy 8 nu. So this is equal to rest mass of the positron. So it is m naught c square plus rest mass of the electron m naught c square, okay, plus the kinetic energy of the positron plus the kinetic energy of the electron. So the energy of this photon is used to this rest mass energy of electron and positron plus their kinetic energies. So this is equal to twice m naught c square plus e plus plus e minus. So if the pair production happens, then h nu must be greater than twice m naught c square. If the photon has energy less than twice m naught c square, then pair production is not possible. So twice m naught c square, this is called threshold energy. And you see here energy, gamma photon means energy. Energy is converted to positron and electron, that is matter. So this is called materialization of energy. This is called materialization of energy. And reverse of this, if two electron and positron combine and gamma photons produced, then it is what happens, the material is converted to energy, and this is called annihilation of matter. This is called annihilation of matter. In annihilation of matter, positron and electrons forming photon. So one electron positron pair combine and produce two gamma photons. This is annihilation of matter. Matter into energy, materialization energy. Materialization of energy means energy to material. So in this pair production difference. So I want to explain once more, this is highly energetic electron which coming from say outer space, it will interact with the atomic nuclei present in the nucleus. So it will loss energy, and this loss of energy is appears as gamma ray photon, and this gamma ray interact with another atomic nuclei, electric field of another nuclei, and totally absorbed and result in the production of electron and positron pair, and this process continues, and this is called the cascade theory, and this cascade theory is responsible for cosmic ray showers. Now see, what is extensive air showers? It is the cascade theory, but here numbers of cascade forms. So an air shower is an many kilometers wide, that is extensive cascade of ionized particles and electromagnetic radiation produced in the atmosphere when a primary cosmic ray enter the atmosphere. Now see, primary cosmic ray coming from outer space and enter into our atmosphere, and nuclear collisions takes place. After this, number of cascades formed. This is hadronic cascade, this is muonic cascade, electromagnetic components. So these are the processes involved in the extensive air showers. So numbers of particles produced, and this is called extensive air showers. And it is observed that if we observe the particles produced with depth of the atmosphere from top of the atmosphere to ground level, then at the top of the atmosphere mostly it is proton that are coming from the outer space. So top of the atmosphere proton, after that neutral pi mesons, after that positive and negative pi mesons, and this is the aeroplane height, and lower to this mu mesons, neutrino and electromagnetic radiation, and this. So these are the particles produced, and this is extensive air shower. Now I want to conclude my discussion, and I have sent some assignment for you. Here some questions. What do you mean by east-west asymmetry in cosmic rays? So just write east-west asymmetry. The number of particles coming from west is greater than east, and the reason behind the east-west asymmetry. So you can answer this question. Next, what are cosmic rays? Distinguish between primary and secondary rays. Primary rays are coming from outer space, and secondary rays are formed when these particles collide with the atomic nuclei. So you can answer this question. What are cosmic ray showers? Cosmic ray showers, discuss the theory of their formation, which I explain the cascade theory. Discuss the effect of Earth's magnetic field, latitude and altitude on them. These are the effects of cosmic ray effects. I already explained. So please answer these questions and send to me, you mail to me the assignment. So thank you very much.